Good evening, everyone. We're going to get started. People are going to straggle in, and that's okay. My name is Cherise Berta. I'm the executive director of the Ryerson City Building Institute, and welcome tonight to our AV meetup. So first, I want to thank all of you for being here tonight. This is such a busy time of year, and I know all of you here usually have, you know, 5 events every night of the week that you're invited to. So we really appreciate that you chose to be with us tonight. We think you're going to have fun. We're going to try and keep the event under 2 hours. It's going to be live streamed. So the first thing I'm going to ask you to do is take out your phones, put them on mute, but keep them out, because we want you to join our Twitter conversation. And our hashtag is AVMeetup. So please join in on that. Just a quick word about this building, the space that we're in. This is a student learning center at Ryerson University. It's won awards for architecture. We're really proud of it here. But I'm really excited about having this event here instead of a stuffy conference room, because it's a public space. And it's windows open to the city, and we're talking about the city, and it's full of students, and that's the next generation. So it just seems really, really appropriate. The doors are open. As you know, people are going to be walking in and out, and that's all part of our disruptive conversation, right? So it is going to be a very informal event. We don't have a regular panel that are going to be talking individually. It's what we're calling an unpanel, and they're going to be having a conversation with each other and hopefully with you as well. So feel free to be engaged, part of the conversation, laugh, applaud, and at the end we're saving 15 minutes for you to ask them questions. In terms of that, do we have a couple of people, Claire and Alicia? You guys are going to have the mics later when they ask questions. We'll make sure they get to you. Okay, great. We are thrilled and honored to have Steve Paikin as our moderator. As you know, he's one of Canada's most respected journalists. He's the host of TVO's wildly popular The Agenda with Steve Paikin, and the most popular public affairs show in Ontario, if not the country. Steve knows more about this province than anybody in Ontario, except maybe Minister Del Duca, sorry about that. And after tonight, he's gonna know everything about automated vehicles. So please join me in welcoming our moderator, Steve Paikin.
Hello. Hello. Don't you think that was a little over the top? Do you think any of that was a little over the top?
You're here, right?
I am here. And the good news for me is that these panels are still not autonomously moderated. They need to have a real body here to do it. The minister laughed at that. Okay, that was good. All right.
I think that's funny. Yeah.
It's a good one.
Okay, good. Good. Well, so here we are. Can I start by saying, or I guess start by asking, why do you think this issue that we're going to be focusing on tonight, just by way of introducing everybody to our discussion, why is this the issue that we ought to be caring about and that matters so much?
Well, it's one of the issues. Autonomous vehicles have the potential to be game changers in terms of how we live and move around our cities, and we're already seeing that happening with on-demand mobility. So we thought it was a good time to bring together decision makers and experts to have a conversation about how do we plan for these technologies? How do we get in front of them to make sure that these technologies work for us and help us with our city building objectives rather than potentially causing more problems? So we're going to be looking tonight at 4 key issues. First is transit. Can it help complement our transit system, or will it compete with it? Second, car use. Will we see more cars on the road or fewer? And is it going to help uptake of electric vehicles and reduce our greenhouse gas emissions? Thirdly, sprawl. Just this week, the province introduced proposed changes to our growth plan that call for more intensification in our urban areas and less sprawl, which is great. So will this technology help us achieve those land use objectives, or could it potentially pave the way for sprawl 2.0? And finally, What do these technologies mean for our major investments in transportation infrastructure, such as major highway projects?
Gotcha. Four key areas that we need to look at tonight.
Right.
You've put together a little video to help sort of set the table for the discussion to come?
Yeah, this video helps to frame the issues that we're talking
Excellent.
About.
Excellent. Cherise, thank you for getting it started tonight.
Great, thanks for being
here,
Steve.
Go enjoy the program. And if we could, Maestro, let's roll the video. You can watch it on the monitors in the back.
At the turn of the last century, our cities transformed dramatically because we began redesigning them around the personal vehicle. We're on the cusp of a similar change.
Autonomous vehicles represent an unknown. They could be beneficial to society or they could be detrimental.
Will this technology help to reduce the number of cars on the road? Will it reduce greenhouse gas emissions? Will it help to support transit?
Autonomous vehicles have the potential to dramatically transform how public transit operates across the country. If you could imagine a fleet of autonomous vehicles in a city that are available at a relatively low cost to take somebody from point A to point B, that's a transformative opportunity for public transit.
Buses, with a little help from technology, can be redeployed to axes where we would have demand and where they could be a lot more effective and efficient.
The automobile, more than anything else, changed our land use patterns, not necessarily for the good. It has led to urban sprawl, low density development, and a lot of highways and cars on the road. And now we're facing a lot of congestion and long commutes.
It's great for you to be able to live in the countryside and commute downtown. It's great for you and your friends to discover this new restaurant that's 15 kilometers away and start the party in the car. But it turns into a dystopia when everybody else has the same idea at the same time.
We already know the long commute stinks. So why would we use autonomous vehicles to promote something that we know already doesn't work? This is where the alignment between introducing this new technology and our city building objectives really becomes so critical. What kind of cities do we want, and how can autonomous vehicles help us get there?
If done properly, and if we think about these issues correctly, we could completely transform our urban areas where cars are really just an implementation tool that we don't notice as much. They're in the background.
If you have great public transit, you have car share opportunities, and when you need a car, you can just dial it up and it'll show up in front of your house. Why would you bother owning a car? And if you don't need to own that car, we don't need to be parking cars all over our city. So we can start redesigning our main streets. We can redesign our condos in the downtown.
So the question for us now is, where is Canada going to land on this? Are we going to be a thoughtful, proactive jurisdiction, or are we going to be a reactive jurisdiction that makes decisions in haste?
Nobody! Look at this one!
We've seen in the case of Uber and the sharing economy that waiting and reacting is going to lead to confusion, it's going to lead to protest.
I think it's critical that we plan proactively to make sure that autonomous vehicles and on-demand ride-sharing work for us rather than having this technology happen to us when we're not looking or we're not paying attention.
They can either enhance where we're seeking to go with our cities, or they can detract from where we're seeking to go with our cities. And at the end of the day, that's a choice we make.
Terrific. Very nice video setting up the issues that we're going to be getting into tonight. As you can see, we have divided our guests this evening into three different groups because they perform sort of three different functions for us this evening. In the middle, we've got the decision makers, those people who are essentially accountable to you, the public, led by Stephen Del Duca, he's the Minister of Transportation and the MPP for the riding of Vaughan. Lisa Salzberg is Senior Manager, Systems Planning at Metrolinx. Stephen Buckley is the General Manager of Transportation Services for the City of Toronto. Beside me here, then, we have analysts, those who are sort of researching all of these technologies and their effects, starting with David Tikal, who's with the Monk School at U of T and the author of Driving Changes, Automated Vehicles in Toronto. On the far end, all the way from Paris, France, I think we put that tricolore in the video just for you, Philippe. That was nice. Philippe Christ, International Transport Forum, OECD. Guess where he's born? Guess, anybody?
Nashville.
Paris? No.
Vaughan.
Not Vaughan either, no.
Almost.
He's from Nashville, Tennessee originally. I want to hear if you're going to bring out that southern accent at some point tonight.
I will.
Also, from Ottawa, Julia Markovich, who's Senior Research Associate, Transportation and Infrastructure with the Conference Board of Canada. And then we go over to the far side there with our so-called real-world activators, those people who are working out there on the technologies. On the right end, Barry Kirk from Ottawa. He's co-founder and executive director of a group called CAVCO. That's Canadian Autonomous Vehicles Center of Excellence. In the middle, Jesse Darling, Senior Projects Officer, Brookfield Institute for Innovation and Entrepreneurship. And Jesse, I know you're pinch hitting for someone else who was supposed to come and you came at the last minute. Very good of you to do so. Thanks so much. And finally, Antonio Gomez-Palacio, who is planner and founding partner of Dialogue. How about a nice Ryerson University CBI? Welcome for all of our 9 guests who've come from near and far tonight to be with us. Nice. Let's also remind you that if you're coming in late, where have you been? No, if you're coming in late, please just join. We have lots of seats up at the back here, and we're in a public space here at Ryerson, so just come on in and make yourself comfortable as we continue. A show of hands before we get started. I know this is a very sophisticated audience, but nevertheless, how many people here, before they came tonight, knew what autonomous vehicles were? Hands up. As I suspected, a very in crowd. Okay, very smart. But not everybody knows what we're talking about or what these are tonight. So, Barry, I'm going to lean on you first to give us kind of the Coles Notes version of what we're talking about tonight when we talk about autonomous vehicles, AVs, on-demand mobility, all of that stuff. What do we mean?
We mean, Steve, that the use of technology to do some of the driving functions. There's a whole spectrum. Today, you can go into a showroom and buy a partially autonomous car. Uses technology for intelligent cruise control, lane centering, automatic braking if you see a pedestrian, self-parking. And the car manufacturers are going to keep adding to those capabilities until about in 2020, we will see a fully autonomous car. Ford and others are announcing this, one that you can get in and say, home, James, and it'll take you all the way home with doing nothing.
You're confident that's going to happen in that short a space of time?
Yes, absolutely. Ford and others are saying 2020. If you talk to Google, they say maybe a year or so earlier, but absolutely. And in France at the moment, there's a fleet of 6 fully automated shuttles carrying live human beings. It's a controlled environment, but it shows where the technology is.
In your view, what are the biggest issues around transit that we got to get our heads around here?
When I look at what we're doing, first of all, Ontario is leading Canada. And with thanks to Minister Del Duca and his colleagues, Ontario is doing a lot of a wonderful job. If you look nationally and look at the G7, not only is Canada dead last in the G7, we're way behind the other 6 countries, and we have a lot to do to catch up to really prepare for the benefits of AVs.
Stephen Buckley, I hear the expression, the last mile, used all the time when we discuss these kinds of issues. What does that refer to?
It refers to the idea of supporting transit through modes such as AVs, where a lot of the distance and what people take today is often driving a car just a kilometer or two to get it to a station. Now, imagine a day when you can dial up an autonomous vehicle, it shows up and it takes you to the heavy rail line haul sort of Bloor subway station or whatever it may be. So it's helping to bridge that sort of connection and get people, again, from their origin to heavy-duty mass transit.
Philippe, you've done some studies on this, the effect of AVs on transit in Europe. What kinds of conclusions did you come to?
I think we looked at a particular scenario where we replaced all of the cars, all of the bus trips, many of the other trips in the city with a fleet of self-driving vehicles. And what we saw is that we could deliver the same level of mobility, the same quality of mobility, same timing of trips, the same distances, same comfort, if you will, but with about only 3% of the vehicles. So you could reduce the vehicle fleet in the city, and this was a city in Portugal, it was Lisbon, by 97%. And that is a massive reduction of vehicles. Now, of course, this is a model, but we can see what the magnitude of changes could be with the arrival of these type of fleets. But the other thing, the real lesson from that, is that the real disruption is for public transport services, and especially buses. I'll ask a question right now. How many people think in 20 to 25 years the city of Toronto will have an extensive bus fleet operating?
Buses?
Buses.
So not subways, not streetcars.
Buses.
Buses. Anybody think?
20 to 25 years. That's a quarter century.
Hardly anybody.
I think those of you who raised your hands, you're wrong. I think that is the most disruptive impact of these type of technologies, if they're implemented in the way we've looked at, will be low-density bus services at peak hours will be maybe in the next 10 years an option, but in the next 20 to 25 years, they won't be there, because these technologies might be there.
David?
But Philippe, you do see something else in between self-driving cars and buses, right? What I call automated minibuses, and you call something a little more complicated.
So I don't want to hog the stage right now, but you're right. What we see is a real evolution of public transport, where the type of services we know now, bus, tram, heavy rail, is replaced by a much broader spectrum of on-demand, more modular services. And one thing that we look at this and think about is that necessarily those type of services don't have to be delivered by public authorities. In many cases, you'll see a mix of private and public authorities operating different services. But that requires a new level of governance, and we clearly are not there yet.
Can I tell you what's so confusing about this guy? No French accent, no Nashville accent. I don't know where you're from.
I can come out with a Nashville accent if you want.
David, paint the picture of what you're sort of referring to there with those vehicles you just described.
Yeah, well, so the thing about automated vehicles is they can come in all shapes and sizes. I mean, we're going to have the most typical automated taxi, if you like, will be the size of a golf cart or even smaller. Because it'll be small, you know, it's only going to be for one or two people. The accident rate will be way down, so they'll be very, very lightweight. But then on the other, you know, this other thing I was talking about is an automated minibus, which might hold six or seven or eight people, and it's kind of like Uber Pool, which is on the market right now. And actually, Google is now got a partnership with Fiat Chrysler, and they've chosen to do their initial deployments in a minivan, which to me means they're actually aiming at that market.
Would these sort of mini buses be considered part of the public transit network as you see it?
These are all matters of opinion and debate, but I believe that if we are going to keep the marketplace honest and also to achieve some of our other policy objectives like accessibility for people with disabilities and what have you, that at least a good 20 or 30% of that should be publicly owned public transit.
Gotcha. Jesse, let me come to you. What kind of data do you think we can get from on-demand services, and how might that help us figure out the transit puzzle?
So I think if you were able to access data like from companies like Uber, you'd probably see a couple of really interesting things. You could see what the most popular routes are, what's peak demand, do these vary across the week. But I think it's really important to recognize that it's only by overlaying this type of data with other types of data from different sources that really interesting insights will emerge.
Like what?
To be honest, it's hard to know, but I think the point here is that it's a matter of looking at it in conjunction with public data sets, public agencies, social media networks, the weather network, because looking at the intersection of this information is when you'll never know what really interesting insights might emerge for decision makers, policy makers, civic innovators, or entrepreneurs.
Lisa, tell us first of all, because not everybody will know, you're from Metrolinx. What's their mission?
We have a kind of a three-pronged mission to do planning for the regional transportation system. We also operate Go Transit, Up Express, and Presto. And we also have a strong mandate right now, which is a clear emphasis of our work to build rapid transit in the region across the Greater Toronto and Hamilton area.
How much thinking at Metrolinx is going into a lot of the technologies and new ideas that we're hearing about tonight?
Well, we have some important initiatives underway where we need to really be thinking long term. When investments are made in infrastructure, they're for the long term. They're not just for a couple years. We need to think out way beyond the time frame that we're actually planning to put that infrastructure into service. So for things like station access, how will people get to stations? How will they do that last mile from the station to their workplace? We need to start to think about how these technologies fit into that. My work is thinking about the 25-year perspective. What does this mean for the region? The different markets we have for transit in the region, the different markets we have for transportation in this region, and how can these technologies help us to figure out what we need to do?
Stephen Buckley, how much thinking at the city is going on in terms of the impact of AVs?
So we've been talking about this for about a year and a half now, and it sort of became very real to me when I saw the Google car, to be honest with you, because I'd always been very skeptical of this. And a lot of the earlier versions of automated vehicles back in literally in the 90s were very dependent upon public sector infrastructure. So they required things like magnets in a road. And I really didn't think the government would sort of get its act together to be able to provide that. So the Google car was fully self-contained, did not require any external communications, and that's the one that really scared me. So we started talking about it in the city, and it was quite clear that, you know, we did a little poll, and we could probably do it here. You know, 0 to 5 years, 5 to 10, everyone was very much in the 10 to 20 year range. And then we sort of started talking them through it, and with Barry's team actually came in, and all of a sudden everyone said, uh-oh, we need to start thinking about this. So we do have the other city departments now sort of thinking about how it's going to impact them, everything from parking to revenue to enforcement to curbside regulations to, you know, capacity expansion. What are we doing here? And so, you know, it's good to have this discussion because it's elevating the conversation and getting everyone to talk about it.
Antonio, how do you see the impact of AVs on public transit in particular?
Well, it's fascinating in my mind. In the middle of last century, we all of a sudden kind of got distracted by a new technology. We thought cars were it, and in fact that cars constituted quality of life. But what ended up happening is we started to redirect and redesign our cities for cars. And people had two options. Either they had a car or did not have a car. And public transit was an attempt to really start to fill some of that gap in between. Today, you have way more options in between. You can not own a car, but still have a car nearby. You can have a bicycle. There's all kinds of options in between. So what we need to be thinking about is not how we start to tailor our cities for the new technology, thinking that this new technology is, in fact, the quality of life, but try and figure out what is the quality of life that we're seeking, and then redirect how this technology helps us do that. So the technology in itself is not going to solve transit. It's not going to solve transportation. It's not going to solve these things. But rather, how do we start to deliver the cities that we want and start filling in the gap between all these different options? So it's when it's coupled with reduced car ownership, when it's coupled with all the other modes of transportation, while we are still trying to privilege walking and cycling and all of those other things at the top of that hierarchy.
Good. I want to let this audience know we actually do allow politicians to speak at these things, but I just wanted to give the Minister of Transportation a chance to listen to what everybody else had to say first before weighing in on this. You are, of course, in charge of the Ministry of Transportation in the province of Ontario. What do you see as your role in this whole debate?
So thank you, Steve, for giving me a chance to listen, because there are a lot of people here, not just on the panel, but here in the audience today that have a ton of expertise in an area that's obviously changing quickly and has the potential to do so much more in years to come. There's a couple of things. I know Barry mentioned this off the top. Ontario is the first province in Canada through an announcement we made late last year to permit the testing of automated vehicles on this province's roads and highways. Assuming that an entity, and we define that through the ministry, has successfully applied to the pilot program that exists, which I think is exciting news in terms of demonstrating how committed our government is to taking a look at all of the potential benefits from this particular technology and the disruption that it might bring. So I will say, when I first read in my mandate letter that the Premier gave me a couple of years ago, that part of my responsibility was to advance, I guess I'll call it paraphrasing, a regulatory framework or generally speaking, to advance the concept of dealing with automated or autonomous vehicles, it caught me off guard, because to one of the points that was raised earlier, 2 years ago, two, 3 years ago, I didn't actually know for sure what it meant. Might be disconcerting because I am the Minister of Transportation, but this was two or three years ago.
And the point Do you know what it means today?
I definitely know what it means today, although I hope to learn more about what the potential is here tonight. But I would say, I think that demonstrates how in a very rapid period of time, less than two and a half years, we went from talking about it as a government to putting the pilot regulatory framework out there for the testing of it, and to engage with organizations, with entities like the Ontario Centers of Excellence, to have had conversations with many who are here in attendance tonight about the potential with respect to the outcomes is something that's exciting. The one thing I would say, though, which hasn't come up yet, I think from government's perspective, and I say this with respect to all levels of government, I think one of the things that's most important is that, to use a bit of a transportation pun, I suppose, I think we have to pick a lane on this stuff, all of this stuff.
What's the lane?
Well, I don't know for sure what the lane exactly is, but what I know is that if we, at this critical moment, as the world of transportation is literally transforming under our feet around the world, I know if we're simply reactive as government, that we run the risk of ending up in a situation where we haven't necessarily solved the problems we potentially could solve with the technology. So I think collectively, all levels have to pick that lane, figure out how we're going to get there, draw on the expertise that exists in the private sector and in other sectors, including within our educational institutions and beyond, to figure out how to get there. And then, and I say this as a politician, find the political will to deliver on the lane that we have collectively picked.
How is the testing, the pilot program that you announced last year, how is it going so far? Where is it happening? All of that.
So it's created a ton of excitement, I think, and buzz within the automotive industry, within the technology industry. We've had some very clear excitement that's being generated by the announcement. I will say we actually do not formally yet have anyone participating in the pilot, but the ministry has heard, and part of that might be the challenge of launching something January 1st in a cold weather climate like Ontario is. But I fully expect we will have somebody participating or some entity participating in the pilot before too long.
Philippe, can I get a better understanding from you? We're trying to understand the impact of AVs on public transit. In your view, these on-demand technologies, these autonomous vehicles, unambiguously positive news in terms of their impact on public transit?
What's your view?
No?
Not at all. The rollout, the scenarios for rolling out these technologies are multiple. We've looked at a few. There are others that are possible. But one thing that we do know is the design of these systems, even down to the level of the algorithms for the dispatching of rides and ride services, matters greatly. You can have systems that increase the amount of kilometers traveled in a city, which would not be a good thing. And you have systems that can decrease kilometers traveled in a city, which is a very good thing, both on the congestion side, also on the public safety side, and also on the environmental side. I think there is no one pathway forwards. And part of the, so the idea of having a lane, I have to say I'm a little ambiguous about that, because I think there's so much uncertainty that rather than a lane, we need a new mechanism to decide, you know, which is the road we're going to be on before you even start thinking about
now
the
lanes.
Now
we're mixing our puns.
Yeah, we're going. and I think there are tools for that. And I think one of the things that we see is that faced with uncertainty about this technology, faced with uncertainty about a lot of other trends in society that are happening at the same place, our regulatory framework has to become much more flexible. It has to become more flexible, but we have to be much more answerable in terms of issues relating to public safety, in terms of public outcomes. And I think the answer is there, because never we've had more data to control the outcomes of actions taking place on our streets.
Julian, let me hear you on this, the impact on public transit of all of these new technologies.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that came up in our conference last month, for example, was the role of city size in terms of impact. So the idea that smaller and medium-sized cities would be affected to a greater degree as the rise of this technology. And I think the other sort of important point to emphasize, and again, this came up at the conference, was the HR issue around what happens when, say, transit agencies start using this technology and start building that out as part of their service delivery. We have a pretty serious HR problem. We have a lot of people that work in driving, you know, providing these services that we use, if those services start to be disruptive, like what we're seeing now with the taxi industry, we need to start thinking now about a kind of action plan for how we're going to responsibly manage that transition.
Jesse, unambiguously good news to introduce all these new technologies for public transit?
No, I think the panelists like are presenting a really interesting and relatively equal side of the equation. I think what the exciting opportunities presents itself is the ability to connect what people were saying earlier, the last mile problem in connecting marginalized communities that aren't necessarily best connected to transit currently. And what does that look like when you use these technologies to better connect them to existing rapid transit infrastructure?
Lisa, what do you think?
I think it's a bit about what we want to do with it. So I don't see it so much as a negative, but that, yeah, we have to pick a lane and go forward and know where we're going and where we're headed. And I think Therese said it well, actually, in the video, but how do we make these technologies work for what we need to do in terms of city building or the region? And I think these technologies are entirely compatible with public transit, but we have to shape that path forward.
Barry?
Yep. I look at the size of the city, the size matters. And going back to Philippe's report, big cities like Toronto, you have a very unique set of circumstances, and I think you'll always need traditional transit working in conjunction with driverless taxis. If you take medium-sized cities like Belleville, Kingston, and so on, I can see very clearly that driverless taxis could completely supplant the need for traditional transit. And to small places, I know someone who lives in Arnprior, a small village in the Ottawa Valley, if you don't know, and there's no bus service. And this person's a senior and doesn't have a car and has real mobility issues. And in the future, when we have driverless taxis, hopefully in Arnprior, it'll be a huge improvement on her quality of life, being able to get into a driverless taxi and go anywhere she wants.
David and then Philippe.
Yeah, so I think we've established a couple of things here. Number one, there's a risk that we won't achieve our goals. Number two, if we're going to achieve our goals, we need to use it by relying on information, by knowing what's going on in the streets and by having the right algorithms. There's an elephant in the room for all this, which is the fact that many of these services will be done by private companies, many of them large multinational corporations who are doing this around the world and who think they have a right to own and control the algorithms and the information.
Is that a problem for you?
Well, the problem is this. We don't have policy toolkits for dealing with the digital economy, the information dimension of the information economy. We're very good. We've done a lot of work in our cities, in our provinces, even nationally, around dealing with land use, where we're dealing with private sector corporations. You know, we have entire divisions of city planning that are devoted to that. But when it comes to the information economy and the information dimension of that, as the wealth-creating asset of the 21st century and the ability to achieve our goals as a society, it's a whole different ballgame. And right now, we don't have the policy tools, we don't have the mandates, we don't have the organizational infrastructure within government.
Who do we need to look to make all that happen?
Well, governments need to figure out how.
So him,
do
in other words.
Yes. Exactly.
No pressure.
That is a bit of a cultural shift, though. David and I had a chance to talk earlier tonight before we started the panel. That is a huge cultural shift. The other big cultural shift, and I say this, I don't know how many who are in the audience tonight live or work in the 905. I live in the 905. I've lived in the GTHA my whole life. I will say the other cultural shift is that, as fascinating and as exciting as it is to take a look at the potential opportunities here, there is a strong historic cultural attachment, as human beings, not ethnocultural, cultural attachment to the feeling of liberty that a lot of people in this region still derive from owning their own car and traveling as individuals in their car. I tell the story often about when I turned 16, living in Etobicoke, got my 365 a week after I turned 16, got my license 4 months later, and then have spent most of the rest of my life driving alone in my car in the GTHA. And, you know, with exceptions here and there, I don't think I'm terribly unlike thousands and thousands and thousands of other people who have relied on a system, relied on a past practice for a very long period of time. There will be a requirement for us to, again, work together to facilitate some kind of evolution in that thinking and that approach. And that might be harder than sometimes we imagine.
Philippe.
Let's test it out, though.
Yeah.
Show of hands, if you could only own one, a car or a smartphone? Which one? Who would own a car?
Who wants the car? Hands down, who wants a smartphone?
Sure.
Doesn't that tell you something?
That's a fair point, except for two things. Two things. We're sitting in downtown Toronto right now, yeah. Number one, and I didn't see many hands go up when I asked who lives or works in the 905 or beyond.
So who does? Who's from the 905 here tonight?
A few.
Or
and then
beyond.
Secondly, look at the age demographic with the greatest of respect that we're looking at in this audience. Now, I'm 42, almost 43. I'm guessing that between in my cohort and slightly above, up to people being, you know, a little bit older than I am, I'm guessing that people will actually say to you, why does it have to be either or? Why can't I have a car and a smartphone? And that's, I think, the bigger challenge. Anyway, that's my point.
Okay,
about
Philippe, and then Barry.
So many things to say. The first thing is, you're right about the scale. But we were surprised because we're starting to look at applying the same kind of experiment for the greater London area, so London, UK, and we're finding some of the same results. So it's surprising to us that that same level of fleet reduction could be had for a much larger trip market, and that's a massive trip market in Europe. So that's the first thing. Data. What we're seeing is the information about how and what is happening on our streets migrate from the public sector to the private sector.
Yes.
And we don't have the architecture for understanding how can the public sector ensure its public mandate without access to this data. And that, folks, is a negotiation. It's not a fait accompli. It is something that you engage with those that are collecting this data, and in return for allowing their services the ability to operate on public streets, you can ask for something in return. And that something in return is a level of information about the impact of their services on the street. We don't know exactly what that is going to be like, but we can see already throughout our memberships, we have 57 member countries, that creative cities, and I'm sure that Toronto will be one of those, creative cities are coming up with a new data deal, data-led regulation. So that's another thing.
Barry, Stephen, and then David.
I'm going to disagree with the minister. The early adopters for AVs will be seniors and handicapped people for obvious reasons. And there'll also be the millennials. Studies have shown that younger people, millennials, are getting driving licenses in lower percentages than they have done ever. It's going down over the last 20, 25 years.
I agree.
And you know, I've got a friend of mine, his daughter doesn't like to drive because it's a big distraction to her texting.
So that's good news.
Yes, now but in terms of, but you know, even for people of your generation and mine, we would love to drive. But none of us like to drive. I drive to Toronto two or three times a month. I'd be very, very happy to let the computer drive down the 401. What's going to happen is the car is going to evolve and in 10 or 20 years be more like a boat or an ATV, something you do on weekends when you want to have fun. But when you're commuting, you let the computer do the hard work.
So Steve, if I can say, sure. Because he disagreed with me, and I don't have the power to revoke his driver's license, so I will say, I like to pretend that I do sometimes, but I don't. I will say, let me just make sure that I'm completely clear about what I said earlier. I don't think that the evolution is impossible. I have two young kids, two daughters, 8 and 5. I fully anticipate that because we're gonna get this right, one way or the other, that their future, their transportation future will look dramatically different from what my life has been as it relates to transportation. I just want to make sure that we are all realistic to recognize that when there are roughly 8 to 9 million, I think, licensed drivers in the province of Ontario currently, from what I remember of my briefing notes, I will say to you that we have a lot of work to do, but we have to be reasonable in our expectations that we're going to flick a switch and make this change overnight, which kind of goes back to the heart of the question that we've talked about. Will public transit and automated vehicle technology complement or cannibalize? I will say that at least for the next generation, it has to be a complementary relationship because there is no imaginary switch that we can flick and change that culture or make that cultural shift happen overnight. But I do agree, it is something that definitely can and I hope will happen.
Let's finish the segment on public transit with David, Stephen, and then Antonio.
Okay, well first, a quickie on this issue of car ownership and people not wanting to give it up. In Canada, even in the United States, there's no Second Amendment for car ownership, so we can just take them all away from people. No, but...
have you heard of election campaigns?
But for me, listen, I'm going to confess to something to everybody here today, which is that I'm expecting a grandson, and he's actually due to be born officially tomorrow. Ooh. My biggest concern is not congestion, it's not urban sprawl, it's climate change. Because if we can't survive as a species, then all this other stuff will be secondary. I believe that a strong policy and strategy that will be compliant with climate change will also achieve our other objectives around urban design. But if we want to achieve our, we want to maximize our climate change objectives, the only way to do it is to maximize the use of shared mobility, maybe 80%, to get up to Philippe Crist's forecast of 90% or more climate reduction or GHG reductions. And that is the number one imperative. You know, this is a societal global imperative. We need to do this if we're going to survive as a species.
Stephen, then finally Antonio.
Yeah, no, I think we're touching on a lot of interesting points here. The one thing that we brought up in the work that we had done with David was there are sort of, we sort of set up two scenarios, and David sort of alluded to it. One is a sort of private ownership model, and one is the shared model. We really haven't talked about how that's occurring. And what we see right now is all the traditional manufacturers, GMs and those sorts of companies, layering on technology to sort of continue with the private ownership model. And then you sort of see this other model, which we'll call the robo-taxi, which is sort of the shared use model. And we're going to have a period here where sort of the industry and the market sort of driving this. So to the minister's point here, there, at some point I think there will need to be a public debate about picking a lane. And I think that most of the things we've looked at have shown that this sort of shared use model is probably one that aligns mostly more with city building goals than perhaps continuing with the private ownership model. So I think that's a critical thing we need to sort of think about. And then we're going to have this messiness of the transition of having multiple models out there. The shared use model is not going to be as successful if it's going to be in mixed traffic with people who are driving manually. Because those vehicles are going to depend on low weight, battery operated. That's going to drive the cost down and make them feasible. So it's going to be complex, but I think at some point, though, we're going to have a political decision about, are we going to support one model or the other?
Antonio, finish off this segment.
Yeah, I think much of the conversation tends to focus on commuting. Why? Because that's the experience that each one of us cares about. But if you really start to think about transportation as all the different systems, and taxis have turned out to be the canary in the coal mine of the shared economy, right? We've started to have a lot of that debate. Transit, if we can crystal ball a little bit, has the potential to be the canary in the coal mine for a lot of the driverless cars. We're going to start to see some of the impacts on policy, some of the social impacts start to manifest itself through transit. But in fact, it's a much bigger piece. If I was a trucker, if I was a courier, if I was in any way related to goods movement, I'd really start to want to reinvent what my future is going to start to look like. What does warehousing and distribution systems look like in the years to come? And I think we saw some of that happen in past decades when boats and transportation through boats got automated. We went from ports that had thousands of people working in them to now you have one fellow with a crane managing all of these things. And suddenly all areas of the city became opened up for development and other pieces. As transit starts to kind of open up the agenda, create new policy and other forms of transportation, we're going to start to see some huge social and economic impacts.
The disruptions are endless, aren't they? All right, while you've got the floor, we remember Cherise Berta's list of the four things that we want to look at tonight. Let's go to the second, and that's urban sprawl. As you look into the future, what kind of an impact on urban sprawl do you see autonomous vehicles and these new technologies having?
Well, I do believe there's a lot of people who are going to start to think, hey, I can now start to fall asleep in my during my commute, right? I can start texting or doing all kinds of this. So the level of tolerance for commuting has the potential to significantly increase. And that has typically been a barrier to development, a natural barrier.
We do or don't want that to happen.
We don't want that to happen. And this is where we can't just assume a wait and see attitude towards driverless cars. We really need to be ahead of the game and be creating some of that policy because it's going to be sprawl, but it's also the number of trips. I can now send my dog to the vet on its own in a driverless car. Why not? Right? I can start doing all kinds of things that I might not have been able to do in the past. through a driverless vehicle.
Do me a favor. Don't do a Mitt Romney and put the dog on the roof, okay? Put the dog inside the car if you're going to do it. Julia, let me go to you next, because the Conference Board recently had a conference about all of this kind of stuff, on urban sprawl in particular. What did you learn at that?
Well, at that conference, actually, the Canadian Automobile Association released results of a recent survey around the driverless car. And what was sort of interesting were some of the findings on this issue. How attractive is this idea of commuting even further away to get to work? And actually a minority, only about 11% of their survey said that they would definitely be interested in that opportunity, working even further from home. At least 34% were not at all interested, and then the rest are kind of a mix because the question was sort of asked on a sliding scale. So I still think there's a lot more research that needs to happen around that. We need to have a lot more engagement with our publics around how they intend on using this technology. But certainly, as Charisse mentioned earlier, we're in a good time in many ways because we've had the province, you know, release their guidelines for revising their plans. Metrolinx, of course, is in the process of its revision of the big move. And as more municipalities start to, you know, revisit their official plans, there's an opportunity now to articulate some of this thinking in those documents.
Philippe, do you also see a potentially perverse, more perverse future with AVs having a negative impact on urban sprawl?
Well, absolutely. I mean, I think the two models that were studied here in Toronto give you an idea of what the two worlds could be, the two extremes. One is an optimized short trip city with a lot of on-demand mobility services, and the other one is basically 2010, let's call it, carried out for the next 30 years, where automated vehicles are owned by households and used very much by individual households, never shared, and often driven empty, sometimes with pets in them, sometimes with children in them, and a whole host of new trips occurring. Why are they occurring? Because there's no cost to the household for those trips. So there's a greater question of how do you actually regulate the use of public space in an area where it's become so easy to park, well, not park, but keep store your car on public roads in movement. And that's something that we have to start thinking about in terms of forward-thinking regulation. If we go down this pathway, is there a cost to society for that? And if so, how do we make sure that users, households, pay for that cost, for that occupation of space? Because it can be quite bad. You can see scenarios, and there are a number of scenarios, where you see a big increase in the amount of vehicle kilometers traveled.
David, tell us what you see in terms of long commutes and impact this will have.
Yeah, so first of all, with respect to long commutes, you know, I to Cheryl's point about sprawl 2.0, I think actually, you know, with the new provincial guidelines and the emphasis on complete streets instead of and walkable and bikeable communities as opposed to, you know, car-dominated suburbs, you know, it won't be quite as bad as it is today, at least from a health perspective and a personal lifestyle perspective. So I think that's not necessarily so bad if we can support a lot of it with mass transit as opposed to cars. But the other side of it is that the one thing that, you know, this model that we've been kind of painting does for us is it gives us opportunities to make life in the city far more attractive. We're going to free up a lot of parking spaces. On residential streets, it might be even conceivable that, you know, can actually have people walking on the road and biking on the road and sharing the roads with these self-driving cars that are going to be much more attentive to safety than cars with drivers in them. And, you know, we should be putting in a lot, we're already putting a lot more bike lanes. So I think we should be doubling down on a lot of today's progressive urban planning things that are happening in the city and actually putting that on the table when we do our consultations.
Let me put this to the minister. I've seen you make a lot of announcements over the past year or two.
Thank you for noticing.
$1 billion for Mississauga for a new LRT right up here, Ontario. $1 billion for the city of Hamilton for a new LRT there. And on and on it goes. Are you at all concerned that you are trying, through these announcements, to get people to use public transit in the parts of Ontario beyond the 416? And yet, in fact, your neighbors are more than likely, if this technology becomes available, they're going to want to sleep in their cars as somebody else drives them to work automatically.
I mean, there's always reason to be concerned about unintended consequences. But, I mean, none of these things moves in isolation. A few others have referenced that earlier this week, my colleague, Minister McMeekin, Municipal Affairs and Housing Minister, announced our proposed updates to the growth plan. We see a dramatic increase in the intensification targets, the requirements around people and jobs per hectare. A stronger requirement around complete communities, and I think, again, you've got to look at the totality of all of the policies moving in lockstep across multiple ministries. You know, I think we sent a pretty clear message earlier this week that we have to do a better job of making sure that we have a more sustainable way to move ourselves, to move goods across the region, to develop the lands that we have. We've seen over the last 10 years, since the original sort of Greenbelt growth plan about 10 or 11 years ago, we've seen the rate at which land is being consumed has been dropping here in the Greater Golden Horseshoe. These new numbers that we're putting out, that we put out this week, now that they go out for consultation until the end of September, I think help to drive home that message. So we can't pretend, nor do I believe anyone here, particularly a Ryerson, pretends that transportation planning should be delinked or can be delinked from how we're planning our communities. But you know, that's the whole point of those things working together. And I think they are working better together today than they probably have at any other point in my lifetime. But we still have more work to do.
It would be a terrible irony, though, if after announcing billions of dollars more for public transit, the effect of that actually, because of these new options and new technologies, was that more people actually wanted to drive from the suburbs, from the 905 into the 416, right?
Yeah, I mean, again, I'm not too terribly concerned about that. I think that there are a wide variety of policy levers that all levels of government have at their disposal as this technology evolves, as we see that it's working. And that there are other frameworks around it that make it feasible. There are a lot of tools that governments have at their disposal to deploy to make sure that we can align those policies in a more constructive way. The one thing I did mention about the growth plan update, I had the opportunity to stand beside Minister McMeekin in Mississauga. I was there specifically as Minister of Transportation to say that going forward, we are going to use those tools at our disposal to make sure that we are aligning our transportation transit infrastructure investments with zoning at the municipal level across this region to make sure that we are going to have the kind of densities, the kind of intensification. I call it transit-inspired communities. I think it's a great term. It was actually given to me by somebody in the private sector. I think it's a great term, and I think that's what we have to work. That's what we have to work together towards.
Transit-inspired communities.
Absolutely.
Gotcha.
And by tying the zoning to where we're investing, we have a much better chance of succeeding.
Let's get Lisa and then Jesse on this as well.
Say that there's a lot of good literature, I think, to show that people want to live in walkable communities where they can get to places easily on foot, have access to services close to where they live. So I think that vision is going to be what ends up driving us forward. And if we kind of can navigate within the policy sphere that exists now, there's, I think, more of a good news story. I think that tolerance for really long trips and long commutes is probably not there.
Even if you don't have to drive yourself?
Well, I don't know. I drive my kids everywhere, and they complain about how long the drive is. And they're texting, and they're talking to their friends, and they're ignoring me, and they've got headphones on. But they're still complaining about how long it takes to get to soccer practice or whatever. So I'm not sure that we, you know, we're all going to want to live our lives sitting in cars or sleeping in a car, even if, you know, it's getting us to work. And even if we have a TV and a bar, and I don't know if you saw Lauren Isaac's TED Talk, but,
you know road safety is also part of my mandate, so you're scaring me a little bit here.
Good. Okay, Jesse, and then let's hear from Philippe.
Yeah, I think first and foremost, having on-demand mobility increases the number of transportation and commuting options for residents, regardless of where you live. And so in my mind, that's sort of a fundamental characteristic of a modern 21st century city. And I don't want to be the mouthpiece for my generation, but I have no need ever to buy a car. So these provide an option to increase my household disposable income, provide me access to new parts of the cities that currently isn't integrated with existing transit infrastructure. So I think it is a really exciting new opportunity that if we get the frameworks and the policies right, could be transformative.
Philippe and then Barry.
Yeah, I just want to come back to the question of policy levers. How do we in effect lock in the benefits that we can see that occur with the arrival of these technologies, with investments in heavy public transport and high density public transport? And the key is we have to make those efforts. At the same time, when we invest in heavy rail, when we invest in systems, when we allow the arrival of these automated vehicle systems, we have to accompany that with a regulatory framework that locks in those benefits. We can't just let it happen. Because if we just let it happen, then there's a good chance that people will overuse the system as long as it's freely available. And I think that's an important lesson, is that we have to think, what are the strategies that for this type of technology allow us to deliver durably the benefits that we expect to have and that we experience in the first few years of the system implementation? And that is a question of balance.
Barry, then Stephen Buckley.
Building on Lisa's comment about having a bar and so on in the car, and talking about longer commutes, it takes me, well, I gained some notoriety recently by predicting that when computers are doing the driving, there'll be a lot more sex in cars.
Did you guys read this story?
Yes.
Did everybody see this? Everybody heard that this story went all over the world. And it's you who got it done.
Yes.
Okay.
Look at the population impact.
And I mean, I don't want to get too personal here, but is this prediction based on your own? No, never mind. All right. I'm just curious. All right. You think that's really going to happen?
Well, if you talk to long-distance truck drivers, they're sex in cars now. You know, especially long-distance overnight truck drivers. I know that's a safety issue, Minister, but from their high perch, they see, from their high perch in 18-wheelers, they see a lot of sex at the moment. And that's a fact. And
they should keep their eyes on the road.
Yes. What I'm saying is there'll be more in the future.
I want to see the minister's announcement about sex and autonomous vehicles. Is that one coming? That's an announcement I want to be at.
Billboard for it. Yeah.
Stephen Buckley.
I'll go back to, some of the decisions we need to really talk about are the land use decisions and doing things like ensuring that we are intensifying around areas. If the cost of travel, either because you don't feel the pain of it or the actual out-of-pocket cost goes down, you will see segments of society that aren't all urban that are comfortable commuting from Barrie or commuting from Oshawa to the city. So, and then, you know what, if I can go out there and I can bill $300 an hour as I drive into the city, I'll go and buy a big piece of land out there. So I do think it needs to be accompanied by strong land use planning policies.
Antonio.
The coupling of transportation and land use policies is an absolute necessity, and I would echo everything that has been said up to now. I would add only to that there's going to be a couple of areas where we don't yet know what's going to happen. I'll give you an example. Surface parking lots, structured parking lots, right? We already start to see condos being developed with zero parking. Right, so if I owned a structured parking lot in downtown Toronto, I'd be trying to figure out, is this going to be needed, or do I actually start to build floors in between them and repurpose them because now my vehicles are going to be able to park in completely different ways? Warehousing and distribution, the land use that we dedicate to that, is that going to be needed anymore? Now I can have a vehicle in an autonomous way, start to do transfers on the road without ever having to go into a warehouse. So there's going to be whole segments of our current land uses that we don't only need to direct for transit and direct in these kinds of ways, but we need to start to rethink how it functions in a transportation system that is autonomous.
Can I just confirm what I think I heard you said? They are building condos in this city right now with no underground parking at all.
That is correct.
Zero.
That is correct.
And that's quite common around the world. That's quite common
in Nashville.
Not in Nashville.
That's Houston. That's
Houston. Well, and in fact, they if they have a few, it's shared cars.
Yeah.
Huh. Right? It's so for zero private ownership.
Fascinating. David.
Just a couple of other points. So another lever, of course, is the pricing mechanism, both making the use of mass transit cost competitive with being in a car, and road pricing for these vehicle, for those $300 an hour people who want to do their work while they're driving to and from work. I guess they'll be okay with it, but a lot of other people won't. But I think also another dimension of this is that I think we need, as part of this, we're moving into a completely new kind of world where everything about our lives is going to change as a result of this transformation. It's like when we moved from the 19th century to the 20th century with the internal combustion engine. We need to have a conversation as a society about all of these dimensions, and we need to put out the values that we think we want to achieve. It comes back to the question that a couple of people ask, and Steve has asked many times, which is, how do we use vehicle automation to build the city or the society or the Canada that we want? And you can unpack that question. Each of those words is loaded. Who is we? What do we want? What do we mean by a society, and so on. So, but really, we need to put that question. We're kind of talking about it here, yeah, but we need a broader discourse about that question. And so, when we talk about these land use implications and congestion and sprawl and all the rest of it, and what does that mean in terms of global warming, climate change, and urban design, and the quality of life, then you know, people need to buy into that stuff, and you need to make it explicit.
Let me suggest that at the end of the day, a great deal of political leadership is going to be needed to, to be brought to bear on this. So I want to give the last word in this segment to Stephen Del Duca, because I don't expect you to know what's going on in other ministries, but there's a lot of things that are under review right now by your government. You've got the Greenbelt review, you got a growth plan review, you got regional transit that's going in all over the place. Are all of these reviews and considerations thinking about the impact of all of what we're talking about tonight?
Yeah, absolutely. There's an immense amount of coordination across all of the ministries, and of course, the Premier's office itself and all of the agencies that we, including Metrolinx and others that we have the chance to work with. And I already referenced a little bit tonight the updates to the growth plan that we announced earlier this week. I think the larger question, and so not to be a bit of a downer with respect to what David talked about, because I think he's right in general terms. I think the big challenge we have is not whether or not in this particular moment we can envision the outcomes we want and then work towards those. The big challenge we have is that we have to remember, we as elected officials deal with electoral cycles. Now, it's a really interesting time in Ontario's case right now, because for the first time in my memory, and Mr. Paikin, who's a great historian, can tell me if I'm wrong or right about this, but for the first time in my memory, we have a provincial electoral calendar and a municipal electoral calendar that are somewhat aligned, in that we are both going back to the people in 2018. But every 4 years or so in this province and amongst all 444 municipalities we have, we need to seek, notwithstanding what that vision is, the consent of those we govern so that we can keep delivering on outcomes that will take a lot longer than 2 or 4 years to deliver on, particularly as it relates to the benefits that we anticipate we'll gain from this versus the displacements and disruptions that I believe to an extent will be felt during the transitional period. And that to me, perhaps is the largest challenge we're facing.
Okay, can I go on, or
just one more point?
One quickie, go ahead.
Well, this is a once in a century opportunity.
Yes.
We only have one chance to get it right.
That's true.
That was ominous. Okay. Let's move on to segment three now. We want to talk about the issue of car use. Barry, I want to go to you first. You advise cities and companies on these issues. What are you telling your clients right now about the future of car use?
I agree with the report, the analysis done by Morgan Stanley in the US, which says that we are witnessing the start of a complete major change to the auto industry. Major change, the car companies would like to see humans in the driver's seat, and there'll be a lot fewer of those in the future. There are a lot of new entrants there. I think it's the technology companies who are really doing a lot of the good work. Google, Tesla, Local Motors, and others. And one of the things we need to keep focused on here, a wise man told me recently, and I believe him, that the reason Google is spending so much money on self-driving cars is not cars at all, it's data. Mm-hmm. They want the people who own the cars, own the sensors, own the data, and Google can monetize that and make far more money from the data than they can from the cars. They can use that big data analytics and target advertisements to each of us far more precisely than they do now, and that's where the real money is.
Target advertisements in the cars?
Sure, if you're not driving, why not? It's a distraction to sex.
It always comes back to the sex with you, doesn't it? Yeah. Jesse, what about it? The notion that this is a lot more about accumulating information than it is about car usage.
Yeah, I have to agree. I think, and we touched on this earlier about the fact that there's not an existing digital toolkit and regulatory framework to kind of figure out who owns that data. And in the current sense, it would be Google, but is there this negotiation technique that cities could use as leverage to better understand what's happening on their streets? So I think it's a huge issue that we don't know what the implications are yet.
Steve?
You know, I use this one as an example. I mean, you could think of these guys coming along at some point and, hey, say we go to a shared mobility model and, you know, you're in LinkedIn. Hey, do you want to commute with Barry Kirk for an extra $5 today? Because he's the guy you're trying to pitch. I mean, you could really think about how this could get out of control in a bad way. And so I agree that there is a lot of the partnerships you hear about now, they're sort of getting together and then breaking up because they're fighting over who's going to own the data. So
you do,
it's a challenge.
I do want to follow up with the minister on one thing, and that, you know, I'm a lot older than you, but we're both of the same generation in so far as soon as we turned 16, we wanted our driver's licenses. We wanted our own cars as quickly as possible. You're in the 905 where, you know, the car is in some respects a way of life right now. Do you imagine a future where the people that you know in Vaughan are going to be content to share ownership of vehicles when they live in houses that have got garages big enough for three cars?
I'm
exaggerating
a little bit. No, but not by much. I mean, I live on a street where there are, I think, 12 houses, and I think close to 30 cars on those 12 houses. And that's, I think, a fairly accurate estimate of what you see in most of the subdivisions in the riding that I'm proud to represent. I'm an optimist by nature, so I believe, yes, in the future there will be that shift. I think what we have to show my constituents, though, is what that value proposition is. They don't feel it right now. If I went to them today and said, we can accomplish all of this if you switch, if you give up, they don't feel it right now. One example that I didn't get a chance to use earlier, but I will, I have a couple of GO stations that are in my riding or close to my riding, Rutherford and Maple GO station. The Maple GO station, since 2003, we've added in the neighborhood of 1,200 to 1,300 parking spaces at that GO station. Every time we add new GO parking, it gets used, it gets filled up right away. When I go to greet commuters in my riding at that GO station, the biggest challenge they're facing is that they can't access parking, and we can't build it fast enough. GO is the single largest parking authority in Canada. How many spaces?
72,000
spaces in the GO network right now. And you see them along the Lakeshore West and East Corridor, the parking structures. We can't keep pace with the demand that's out there, and we're about to dramatically increase through Regional Express Rail the amount of GO service we're putting out there. My point in all of this is to say, when I talk to people who live in my community about getting to the GO station, many of them live near each other, but they don't even contemplate the existing public transit that we have in that part of York Region along major traditional arterial roads, because it doesn't suit their lifestyle.
But if you can figure out how to get them into AVs so they don't have to park, so it's just house to GO station, car goes off and does something else, you don't have to build any more parking spots. Possible?
Not just potentially, if we get really kind of outside the box, not just not build more, but it's a tremendous, I would argue, a tremendous public asset that sits there, 74,000 spaces. How many acres does that represent? What could be done with that when we're talking about building communities that are effectively, talking about transit inspired, essentially communities, other options sitting right beside GO stations, as again, we dramatically increase the level of GO service. There's a huge opportunity there, and that's one of the reasons that I'm optimistic, if we get this right around the technology, that we can optimize that asset.
Let me tap into Julia's knowledge again from that conference that you put on. Do you imagine a future where people will care less, even people who have an hour-long commute right now, they'll care less about owning their own vehicle?
Well, it's interesting. I mentioned that CAA survey, and again, with those 2,000 participants, overwhelmingly two-thirds were still in favor of a private ownership model. About 20% were really interested in the shared mobility model. So I do think that, you know, as planners, of course, the idea of a shared mobility system is so attractive for so many reasons, but it is important that we keep in touch and engage with, you know, with our residents, because they may have very different views about the technology. But I think the other issue is a sort of question of trust. I mean, I think a lot of people right now are not necessarily prepared to completely trust this technology. And so that may be feeding into some of their concerns about, you know, ownership or sharing with other, you know, unrelated individuals. So I think there's, you know, some issues there to work through. But the key is to keep in contact with residents on this.
Philippe, then David.
I'd just like to come back to the permanence of what we see in our land use patterns, because right now in many cities in North America, but also in other places in Europe as well, we see a urban core that is gentrifying in many cases, more so in North America than in some places in Europe, where it stayed very much a very high-income area. And we see the pauperization of the outer ring now. In many places, especially in the far south of the United States, where there's been a lot of construction, the poorest areas are the most far-flung suburbs. And these are the ones that have the most need for, right now, public transport, because having a vehicle is a huge cost on top of the mortgage that they can barely afford anyway. So we shouldn't expect that the future will have the same pattern of high-income households in the suburbs, lower-income households, or young households in the center. I think all of that will change. And that's another difficulty. That's some of the uncertainty that cities are facing, is how do you deal with providing for the mobility needs of those that may be low income, that are further flung away, that have off-peak jobs, because they're not, they're oftentimes in the service industry jobs. And are those service industry jobs going to stay the same over the next 10 or 20 years? And those that can afford the best housing and have the most transport options in the center? Those are questions, again, that we don't know the answers to.
David, then Antonio.
I think we should think about this question in another way, which is how do markets take off? And you know, when the iPhone came out, you know, it was very quickly adopted, and there was a lot. It was mainly with a certain demographic, and then it went from there. So on this, there are a couple of points I want to make. First of all, cost, which you kind of alluded to, it'll cost maybe 20 or 30% what it costs to keep a privately owned car on the road. So instead of $10,000 a year, it might be $2,000 or $3,000 a year. A lot of people will be influenced by that fact. There's a young demographic that we've all agreed will be into this right off the bat. And then on top of that, I'm going to give you some numbers. Please let me bore you with a few numbers. This is what I call the ability demographics of people who have limited access to personal transportation today in the city of Toronto, which is a population of, by 2030, it'll be about 3 million people. By 2030, roughly, we'll have 500,000 people who are over 65. 200,000 of them will be over 75. 450,000 will be between the ages of 5 and 19. 100,000 people will have significant disabilities, which make it difficult for them to use today's modes of public transit. And we'll have about 700,000 low-income people, many of whom today are constrained by taking public transit, but it's for a lot of them, it's very inconvenient. So that all of those will be natural markets for on-demand automated vehicles. And in fact, the question that I think we really should be asking ourselves is not whether we'll have sufficient demand for this technology, but whether let's say we get the, you know, kind of an ideal scenario, 80% of all trips in Toronto are being provided by on-demand automated vehicles. We'll have a lot fewer cars in the city over the course of a given day, but at any given moment, we're at risk of having many, many, many more cars on the streets than we have today.
That's a fascinating conundrum. Let's do Antonio, and Jesse, I'll give you the last word in this segment, and then we'll go to the fourth segment.
As we try and encourage people to use more sustainable forms of transportation instead of less, we talk about how to do a little bit of a catch-up with the land use policies and try and adapt our cities in doing that. I'm going to use a word that our public sector is not going to like very much, and that's taxes. We need to start to figure out how do we readapt in the same way that we readapt land use policies, our taxing system, to actually incent the behavior that we do want and not the reverse.
What does that look like?
Well, right now we are perversely incenting exactly what we don't want. So say, for example, property taxes. We base them on land value, so that bungalow in the suburbs pays less property taxes, yet costs much more to municipal services and has a higher impact on the infrastructure that we need to build. So perversely, we're actually subsidizing exactly what we're trying to discourage. We need to start to readapt our taxing system in a way that it actually translates and still provide those options. So somebody wants to have that three-car garage, happy to do so, yet they need to start to pay for the cost of doing that.
I want to see you get elected on a platform of telling Ford Nation that their taxes are going to go up because they're using the roads more. Try that on for size, Antonio. How does that look?
Well, that's some of the tough decisions that we do need to make. And, you know, when 18 years ago, my wife and I did exactly the same calculations, and I'm older than the minister, and we sold our cars and raised two kids and haven't had to turn back since.
Where do you live?
By Hyde Park, but we tailored our lives accordingly, but increasingly there are choices that people are starting to make, and I think as a society we really need to start to think about, well, what are some of the behaviors that we see are more sustainable and start to deliver the quality of life, and what are some of the behaviors that we actually want to start taxing.
That's definitely a winning platform in Vaughan, wouldn't you say? I don't see him nodding his head. Jesse, you take the last word here.
Yeah, I think that we're on the verge of a massive change in culture with the way people perceive their relationship with the personal automobile. And I think it presents a really frankly, awesome opportunity to get really creative and solve some major socioeconomic problems that all cities around the world are facing. But here in Toronto, you know, I think in recent reports, the Toronto Poverty Reduction Strategy that just was released highlighted that downtown neighborhoods are accessible by transit by a factor of three. And so could we get creative and look at how AVs and on-demand mobility could take priority neighborhoods and underserved communities and link them to existing infrastructure? The City Building Institute just released a really interesting stat this week. I believe the number was the average household would save $200,000 over the course of 20 years by getting rid of a car, being close to transit. Could AVs have the same sort of impact? We don't know yet, but I do think that there's a whole realm of really awesome and exciting opportunities to explore.
Okay, Julia, I want you to get us into the home stretch here. We're gonna go to our fourth segment. The issues around AVs and the impact they will have on spending on roads, spending on highways, spending on subways, spending on LRTs, spending on other infrastructure. What can you tell us?
Well, yeah, I mean, obviously, this technology is poised to radically change the way we move people and goods. And so it stands to reason that the infrastructure that supports the movement of people and goods might necessarily change, that the demand for infrastructure might change over time. And that already we're seeing lots of questions being raised about what we're investing in and if this will meet the needs or mobility needs of our population in the future. The funding climate that we operate in now is very healthy. We have, you know, multiple levels of government willing to invest in infrastructure, which is really important. But I think because of that, we're reminded of how, you know, capital intensive infrastructure is, and starting to see questions being raised about, you know, what sort of investments are we making. Some of that's being directed towards process, and some of that critical thinking is we're starting to see strong statements being raised about particular types of projects and their, you know, potential viability. At Conference Board, we're very much interested in process, and in our report that we co-authored with CAVCO and the Van Horn Institute, for example, we argued that no infrastructure project now should proceed in Canada without an AV impact audit. So effectively, an additional level of assessment in the planning process that would be mandated to take place before consideration for federal funding, and that this be applied for all new transportation projects.
Fascinating. Is that happening in Metrolinx, Lisa?
I think we're trying to plant the seed, some of us, but I think the desire for transit is very strong in this region. We're making up for a backlog that's been around for a long time, and we're moving quickly to get things underway. So not knowing, it's really important to think as we're building infrastructure that'll be there for 50 years or 100 years even, how we embed some of the thinking about these emerging technologies into our infrastructure planning. So it's clearly an important issue.
Philippe and then Barry.
We work with 57 member countries at the level of transport ministries on transport issues. In this issue of how do we deal with planning infrastructure correctly and right-sizing our capital spend to potential future demand is one that comes back. And frankly, most of our countries, most of our cities are really, really bad at that. We overestimate, in most cases, sometimes underestimate. But the future is already quite uncertain when we talk about major capital investments. And oftentimes we're wrong. And now we're talking about an environment where we have even more uncertainty, not just from automated vehicles, already with transportation network companies. The impact of Uber and Lyft on some of the capital spend is something that we can already see in many cities going forward. And I think in that context, there are risk management approaches that you can use. And one of the classic risk management approaches is having an options-based approach. Right now, the future is uncertain, but if we can give ourselves 5 or 10 more years, an option, without locking in one way or another, an option to make a decision 10 years down the road, then we should take that. And when that means when it comes to capital investment projects for public transport, that means that if we're looking at a metro system versus a bus rapid transport system, you should probably go with the bus rapid transport system at this stage, because in 10 years, you'll get some use out of that, you'll ramp up your usage, and then you can make a decision, you'll have better certainty about what the automated vehicle impact could be. You can already see what the impact of TNCs and other types of services will be. But we have to be better at risk management, and we have to acknowledge that we're really bad at knowing what the future is.
Barry.
Building on both what Philippe and Julia said, The mayor of Los Angeles has publicly questioned why on earth is Los Angeles even contemplating building an LRT system. The reason is, and he says, you know, especially given that in 10 or 20 years' time, we may not even own cars. And his point is, an LRT system is so 20th century. It's fixed route, fixed schedule. If instead of having LRT, you have electric buses, which can go through tunnels, then those bus lanes in the future could also carry driverless taxis. You get far more bang for the buck.
California without cars?
Yes.
It's impossible to imagine.
No, they're way ahead of us.
They are.
Huh. Okay, then I've got to ask the minister the question. Does any of what you're hearing tonight make you pause or reconsider the fact that the government of which you are a part plans to spend over the next 15 to 20 years billions upon billions upon billions for more public transit?
No pause with respect to the existing infrastructure or transportation infrastructure plan that we have as it relates to public transit, whether we're talking about GO Regional Express Rail or some of the LRTs that have been referenced earlier tonight, or BRTs for that matter that we're building or we're helping to support in York Region and elsewhere. And part of the reason for that is that we are still playing a game of catch up here in this region because of the chronic underinvestment that we've seen in crucial transit infrastructure over the last generation. But I think we do have to keep an eye on the future. It's one of the reasons that the Ministry of Transportation is in the process of launching the multimodal transportation plan for the Greater Golden Horseshoe in terms of its review of that plan. And the interesting thing for me is that for the first time ever, the ministry plans to use 50-year modeling as opposed to the increments that we used to use or that we've historically used as a ministry. And I think that speaks to, though it's impossible to know for certain what the future will be, we're trying to do an enhanced job of being in a position to respond. But the other thing I'll say is that in this, not to criticize Philippe because he knows a lot more about this than I do, but I will say, going back to my original point about picking a lane, I think on some of these points, not all, but on some of these points, it can't just be, we can't really predict the future, so we're gonna step back and wait to see what happens. I think along the way, we do have to make some choices. We do have to pick that lane or pick the multiple lanes or stay on track. I'm out of transportation puns now. So we have to do a few of those things because we need to know what the future should look like from our perspective when we're talking about the values, when we're talking about the outcomes, and then find a way again together to get us to that future as opposed to just waiting back and waiting and seeing. So again, it's why the ministry is using, I would argue now, very long-term modeling with respect to the plan.
It's a big bet, though. What if you bet wrong? It's an expensive bet.
It is, but again, you know, we're talking about, in this case, transit, LRTs, GO Regional Express Rail, already very well used. The LRT's case is, for the most part, going along routes that are already very well used by traditional public transit in those municipalities. I would say at the very least for the next generation, while a lot of these other pieces are still moving and still in flux and we're still landing on what the future looks like or will look like, I think we still need to fill that gap. It's a gap that exists because of a generation's worth of underinvestment.
Let's finish up this segment. We'll go Philippe, Antonio, David, and then your questions.
Yeah, I have to say that Toronto is doing a lot more, and a lot more than we see around the world, frankly. And I think that one of the things that we're seeing, and part of this approach to looking at 50-year futures is a component of, is trying to think how resilient are our planning scenarios to multiple possible futures. And I think that is something that we are having to come to grips with. Instead of having bipolar planning processes where it's either this or that, we have to start thinking about multiple options and thinking, well, which of the options that I have in front of me now is most resilient to the greatest range of potential futures? And then pick on those. That's a way, again, it's a risk management approach. And it's something that's quite sensible when you're facing uncertainty. So not to not do anything, but pick the one that is going to be the winner in the most possible cases.
Antonio.
And I would echo the minister's comments. I think we do need to have a compass in this. We need to kind of have a sense of direction where we're heading, and I chair the design review panel for Vaughan and have seen the city do a 180 relative to where the city is growing and be very aspirational in terms of what is looked for in terms of the city. And if we lose that sense and if we start to get a little bit of open it up too much to accommodate a technology without knowing exactly where it is that we want the city to go, we run the risk of accommodating things that in fact lose us and lose the focus of what we're trying to do. So we need to keep the city as the forefront, not a technology as the forefront.
David.
Just a couple of points. First of all, Philippe, your work did show a strong complementarity between on-demand mobility and large-scale mass transit.
Large-scale mass transit.
Yeah. Yes. So and that's what we're talking about here. So let's just be clear about that. But I think you know, again, it's sort of about timing. We're Canada is at a point of doing massive infrastructure investments all across the country, particularly in Ontario, but not just in Ontario, at a scale that we haven't seen for several generations. And the federal government is really pushing this forward with its investment plan. And as people may recall, there are two phases. The first phase is like get the shovels in the ground, do a bunch of stuff right away. But they say they're working towards a second phase, which will be more considered and more strategic. And we're going to hear about that in 2017. So everything we're talking about here and all the considerations we're discussing here, hopefully, in that policy and strategy work that they're doing, they're going to take vehicle automation into consideration and electric into consideration.
Good. Okay. Thank you, everybody. I now want to invite all of you to join in our conversation here tonight. Claire and Alicia, put your hands up. Where are you? Claire and Alicia are here. They've got the microphones. When they see hands, they will run around to you. For those of you who are sitting up here in the back, if you come to the aisles here where they can get to you on either side, that would be really helpful as well. We've asked a guy to launch our question and answer session tonight, and how do I put this? You are one of the most influential men in the in the province of Ontario, and no one knows who you are.
Here.
It's an amazing thing. This is Steve Orsini, who is the Secretary to the Cabinet. He is essentially the Premier's Deputy Minister, and we're delighted to see you here tonight. Why don't you start us off?
Well, thank you very much, Steve, and thank you to the panel. I really, really enjoyed the conversation. Because you're raising fundamental issues that we have to grapple with as a society. And stepping back and looking at the rapid pace of change is really important so we don't lose sight of our compass. But one thing I want to flag is we've taken technology as an external force, and it is. But let's not forget Ontario is a major IT technology hub. So my question to the group is, with the rapid change of technology, you might have read over the weekend, blockchain that Don Tapscott's talked about, fundamental change in our economy. You got financial technology companies that will remove intermediaries. You got IT, artificial intelligence, machine learning. You have all those things. The province can't lose sight of being a force for that new technology. It's crucial to our next generation of manufacturing, our service economy. So my question to the panel is there a way that we can continue on one hand, promote economic growth, fostering innovation hubs and new technology, and at the same time, work with that technology to integrate it with a society that people want to enjoy?
Thanks for starting off the Q&A. Barry, you want in first.
Yeah, the simple answer is yes. And there's a huge opportunity for the technology industry. At the moment, a typical car, 4 to 5% of the value is technology. When you have a fully automated vehicle, you'll have between 40 and 60% of the value of a car will be technology. A lot of business opportunities for the Ontario tech sector, for the whole global supply chain. And I've been working with some stakeholders in Ottawa to try and create an Ottawa-based AV cluster, working with the National Research Council, Invest Ottawa, City of Ottawa, and Canada North BIA. And we had a breakfast about a month ago, and Julia was there. A huge amount of interest in cooperating so that companies can work together, help each other, and feed into that global supply chain. And one of the winners so far, a real example for all of the tech sector, is QNX, the subsidiary of BlackBerry. One very quick factoid. Today, was it May the 12th? Over 60% of all the cars coming off all the world's production lines have QNX software embedded in it.
Wow. What are the implications of that, or what?
The implication, QNX know how to sell technology, especially software, to all the car manufacturers without getting wedded to any one of them, and they've been really very, very successful.
So we're driving computers, really, these days, aren't we?
Well, and even more so in the future, yes. Mm-hmm.
Antonio.
I'm particularly excited by the spin-off technologies, and in the same way that when we went to the moon, there was all kinds of spin-off technologies that came out to this, I think the knowledge that is going to be generated ought not to be limited to a single occupancy vehicle. And I'll give you just one example. Seeing eye dogs cost thousands and thousands of dollars today. But the same technology that helps a vehicle navigate an urban environment can be readapted to somebody who is visually challenged to be able to walk through that urban environment, right? Same technology, but now we've gotten rid of the car. We can now start readapting it in other things. And Ontario can be leading in many of those industries as well.
Great. We've got a question down here in the front. Thank you, ma'am.
Given that societally we have to be heading in the direction on that compass toward a fully decarbonized economy by 2050, 34 years from now, to David's earlier point, can you give us some sense of the magnitude of the distance that will be accomplished in going to AVs? Like, how much of that goal will be achieved in measurable terms thanks to the advent of AVs?
Nice. Philippe?
So in our modeling, again, this is a mid-sized city. We're doing it for a much larger city, but they're both European cities. What we found is that with the optimized algorithms, a good dispatching system, we saw a 34% reduction in CO2 emissions for the same level of mobility as today, same quality, with ICE, internal combustion engine technology. So that's today's technology. You could already, in an optimized system, see a third reduction in CO2 emissions. And that goes because the optimized system produces far fewer vehicle kilometers. Now, you can imagine two things in addition to that. One is you can imagine electrifying that fleet. And clearly, that is an option. There are some impacts on the efficiency of the system because the vehicles have to come offline to be recharged, and they have range issues. You know, they can't operate 200 kilometers per day with current technology. But even accounting for that, we saw very minimal changes on the amount of fleet required. And in that case, you have zero on-road emissions. Now, depending on how you produce that electricity upstream, then you might have some significant reductions as well. The third thing is because of the rapid technology cycle, these vehicles go from being used less than 15 minutes per day, which is, frankly, amazing. You know, we spend so much money on these vehicles, and then we just let them sit most of the day. In these systems, you see these vehicles being used upwards of 10 to 11 hours per day. And that means they wear out much more rapidly, and that means the vehicle turnover is much more quick, which means you can introduce new technologies in a much quicker rate. The drawback is that there are, of course, CO2 emissions related to the construction of the vehicles and their disposal. But even taking into those account, you can see a massive reduction, not enough to get to a fully decarbonized system, but certainly in an optimal way, in an optimal scenario, much along that pathway.
Let me, as I ask David and Stephen to follow up, and Lisa as well, let me encourage you all to be as crisp with your answers as possible so we can get as many questions in as possible.
So,
David.
I'm pretty sure these are the correct numbers. 27% of Canada's GHG emissions come from vehicles. Another 6% or so come from the production of petroleum, a lot of which goes into vehicles. So if the demand for that declines. And also, I believe Canada is number two in the world with respect to the carbon footprint, the low carbon footprint of our electricity production.
Stephen, then Lisa.
Yeah, so I think another key thing to identify here is that right now our cars are engineered to carry an engine and protect the occupant, and they're very heavy. And I think one key thing is we're gonna have to come to a point where we say, you know what, you can't be on the road if you're driving as a human. We're going to go through a long transition point. You're going to have cars that last 10 years. They're going to be on the road for 10 years, 15 years. So even if we get autonomous vehicles in 5 years, we're going to have this transition period where you're still going to have humans interacting. But at some point, we've got to say no to humans because we're designing for human error. And to the extent we can start removing human error, we can make lighter weight vehicles. We can make them so that they can use batteries. And all of a sudden, you've really transformed. You're no longer carrying a 4,000-pound vehicle around. You may be carrying a 500-pound vehicle around.
Fascinating. Lisa.
Nothing to do with the numbers, but just to make a big plug for walking and cycling, because I think it's important not to get caught up in the possibilities of new technologies to help us with some of these big challenges of reducing our carbon footprint when we know what's healthier and what's more sustainable. So think a bit about the hierarchy and how we plan our communities so people can walk more and take trips on foot.
This technology gives us a huge opportunity to make walking and cycling far more accessible for people doing everything that they want to do.
I don't mean to be a killjoy, but it also opens up the option of instead of us walking or cycling anywhere, since we won't be emitting carbon into the atmosphere by using our AVs, we may drive more.
Yes. Because in addition, these are door-to-door trips. These are trips that pick you up at your door, and right now, if you're taking the bus, if you're taking the metro, you have a walking component. The health impact could be substantially big if people stop walking and walk less.
People like to walk and bike. They'll do it if they can.
Good. Who's got the question out here? Who's got the microphone? Up in the back, and then we have a gentleman here in the second row next. Right there.
Hi. We've had private vehicles on the road for over 100 years, and there isn't really a comprehensive planning framework in place yet to control them. So I guess I'm just a little bit cynical. How really effective can we be in introducing a policy framework to manage this issue within the time frame with which people are expecting it's going to occur?
Minister, I'm going to give you that one.
So thank you for the easy question. Is the agenda done now? No, I'm just joking. I think, obviously government has a big role to play, a fundamental role to play, but I think we also have to keep our ears open. I'm serving here tonight or sitting here tonight on a panel with people who have expertise, and there are a ton of organizations out there that are doing some extraordinary work in this regard. But again, it goes back to my original point about what is the outcome we want to see. What levers can we push and pull as government, municipally, provincially, and even federally to get there? I mean, I know I sound like a bit of a broken record on this, but you know, I'm fond of telling my family members who never understood why I ran for office in the first place, there has to be a reason you do this. There has to be a reason, there has to be an outcome, there has to be a vision. It's what we run on during election campaigns as elected officials who aspire to serve. You have that vision, and then you have to have the courage and the strength to withstand some of the turbulence along the way in order to actually deliver on that outcome. And we need that on this issue more so now than I would argue ever before.
Why, when you said turbulence, did you look at me? Never mind. In the back, please.
Thank you. Marcy Birchfield from the Neptune Foundation. I'm going to bring this conversation back to the land use patterns because I think we wanted to sort of integrate AV technology on the land use side of things. And I heard Antonio talk a bit about the goods movement. And so we've talked a lot about the transit end or you know, car ownership end. But there are a lot of locked-in transit or locked-in land use patterns that are linked to goods movement, warehousing, logistics. And so I'm interested in understanding the changes in technology from the AV point of view and how that will impact and maybe unlock some of that land.
Who do you want on that, Marcy? Antonio, go ahead.
Thank you, Marcy. And in fact, if nobody knows, the work that the Neptis Foundation is doing is amazing work and research in a lot of.
No, they know because she's been on the agenda many times. So it's okay. They know.
But you know, I can imagine that as soon as we automate the movement component, we're going to start to figure out how to automate other aspects of the transportation system. So, garbage, right? We're going to try and figure out, am I really going to carry somebody in the truck just so that they can put the garbage or pizza delivery? There's all other aspects of the transportation pieces. So right now, there's tremendous tracts of the city that we dedicate to transportation and aspects related to transportation. So for example, right now we have warehousing and distribution and huge areas of the city dedicated to that. I can now have a vehicle that in an automated way on the road, because roads are free, we don't tax them, we can have a vehicle transfer goods on its own without any person working on it, so very efficiently, and just rendered redundant all of my needs for a Walmart distribution center. We've got acres and acres and acres of the city that right now we're dedicating to these things, which are no longer going to be needed, same as the parking. So there's going to be a huge transfer of land values to accompany the land use shift. And areas of the city that we're currently not using, little triangular sites, are all of a sudden going to be open for development.
Barry?
At the same time as large areas that, the same as happened with the Portlands or the textile industry.
Quick follow-up,
yep,
Barry?
Yep. My colleague Paul Gottsmark sits on a committee that's exploring a concept for a AV truck corridor all the way between Mexico and Manitoba. And that concept includes air rights, so in fact you would have drones carrying cargo up and down the same over the highway. Google has just been awarded a patent for a self-delivering delivery truck for urban use. And I envisage a future for Canada Post where they go back to home delivery for mail, but using a robot.
And we just had this trial in Europe of the six, the pelotons of trucks led by one driver with multiple trucks behind them. These are six trucks on public roads going from all parts of Europe to the port in the Netherlands, yes, with fully automated function for all the trucks that are tethered to the driving truck. And that driving truck will soon be a self-driving truck.
Yes. Okay, we're going to do two more questions. This gentleman here, and then we'll have some informal conversations after that. Go ahead, sir.
One of the panelists was talking about the need for more flexible regulations, which it sounds like government should do less bad things and more good things. I'm just wondering if there are any examples of success stories of other governments that have already introduced something like this, either in the AV space or anything related.
Barry, why don't you start us off?
Two examples. One is the UK, which has taken a very different approach. They have no mandatory regulations for testing of AVs. That they have best practices, they have guidelines, and that, to be honest, Minister, makes the UK a far more attractive location for testing because it's easier to do it. Texas is, there's been three attempts in Texas to get legislature through the regulations through the legislature. They've all failed. The common law in Texas is that if anything is not banned, it's allowed.
Scary.
So that anything that is, in fact, if there's no regulations, you can do any sort of testing you like in Texas, and it's legal.
Stephen.
But Barry, how do you balance it, though? I mean, we don't want to stifle innovation, but at the same time, if we are overly permissive, as we've seen, putting the genie back in a bottle is a challenge.
Yep. It seems to be working in the UK. They've been very innovative. There are guidelines. So companies are expected to follow the guidelines, but don't have to get an official permit. We'll see how that works out, but so far, they are doing a lot more innovative stuff than we are in Canada.
But most of it is not being most of it is not by companies that are bringing their cars in to be tested. Most of it is the trials that the government has sponsored, as I understand it. So it's not. So even though they've put out those regulations, they're still having trouble attracting the Googles and the Fords and so on to bring their cars to test on the UK's
Philippe?
Roads.
Quite frankly, everyone is trying to attract
That's
Google.
Right. Exactly.
New Zealand has said the whole freaking country,
exactly,
come test our vehicles. We
exactly.
only have sheep. You know, exactly. And but I just want to make a point about the flexibility and regulation because I raised that point. And I think that the regulatory process that we have now is where we have a long period of developing regulations, opening up for public comment, which is necessary and good, and then haggling through the political process of coming up with the regulations, and then those regulations will not budge for the next 20 years, and any attempt to move them is going to be a very hard political game. I don't think that's adapted to what we have now. What we have now is something that has to be much more flexible, much more rapid, and part of that equation is having to say, we will test things, we'll experiment with things, and part of the experimentation is that everyone has to know that we will roll back the regulations. And so I'm French, I have a hard time giving any credence to what happens in the UK, so I'll turn to Sweden. And in Sweden, I think the way in which they put in place a congestion charge around Stockholm is a good example. A highly contested system, putting in place a border tolling system to go into the city of Stockholm. What they said is, we'll put it in, we'll have a partner, IBM, put up the gantries, and we'll test it for 1 year. And in 1 year, we'll go back to the public and say, was it okay? Did you feel that this was a good experiment? And at the end of that 1 year, if the public says no, we will tear down those gantries. I think we have to be prepared for that kind of new regulatory arrangement where we will test, make sure it's safe, and make it clear that if things aren't happening the way that we want it to happen, and by we, I mean society, then we will have to roll back those regulations.
Minister Del Duca, could you get that kind of idea through cabinet?
The cabinet secretary has suddenly disappeared. There he is. Oh, you really want me to answer that?
I really want you to answer that.
I think it sounds like an interesting concept. I don't want to go too far into this issue. I would only say that I think as it relates to some of these transit and transportation challenges, particularly in the GTHA, there remains what I like to call a credibility deficit, because people who have lived, worked in this region for years know that we haven't always put our best foot forward, all levels of government, on these issues. One of the things I said 2 years ago was we have a responsibility to demonstrate we have a plan, we can start to deliver and continue to deliver on this plan, working together to reduce that credibility deficit so that we can afford to be more innovative, because people will have more trust that we can get it right. We're not there yet, but I think we're on that right path.
Gentlemen in the windbreaker, you're going to close it off for us tonight.
My name is Stephen Beta. And so I'm speaking on behalf of a person that is driving electric cars like yourself, Steve, driving an electric vehicle.
How do you know that?
We've met before at the auto show. And but coincidentally, also from an automaker that is actually making an electric bicycle as well as electric cars, I have to raise the question that Lisa kind of addressed about bicycling and an infrastructure to support cycling. And I point out that Denmark has invested almost $1 billion into cycling infrastructure for a 5.7 million population, roughly the same as Golden Horseshoe, or, you know, thereabouts. So, you know, can we get there, or is that, you know, realistic for our Golden Horseshoe area to make that infrastructure investment?
Who do you want to start on that?
Probably Lisa.
Okay, Lisa, go for it.
Well, I'm going to talk about work that I'm doing now. We're looking at the regional transportation plan that we've had in place for the last almost 10 years, and we're doing a review, and we want to hear from people about the kinds of priorities that they see for this region that create a more sustainable transportation system. So I think there are opportunities. There's been a lot of investment in cycling infrastructure over the last several years. Actually, the city has made significant inroads, I think, that provide a foundation to kind of build from.
David, then Barry.
Yeah, so, you know, we have a culture problem in the city. I mean, we just had a debate to open up a few blocks of Bloor Street to bicycles, and we heard complaints about the war against cars, once again, in city council. We really need to have some leadership around this issue from at the political level. And I think also, as I was saying before, we need to be painting the big picture for people. And Toronto should be like Amsterdam, should be like Holland. So we need to build a new narrative for this city, which aggressively says we're going to facilitate active transportation. And I believe, Philippe, that if the infrastructure is there, you know, if I can walk out of my house, on which is right at the corner of Yonge and Eglinton, hop into a bike and cycle right down Yonge Street to get to King and Yonge safely, I'll do it. Even though I can take a subway right there, because it's more fun and because it makes me feel good when I get off. So we need to make that investment as a society.
I want you to name names.
And also the case for this is much stronger when you get to on-demand mobility, because parking spaces become freed up everywhere and they can be turned into bike lanes.
But I want you to name names. You want us to have this conversation. You say it needs to be led at the political level. Who needs to lead it?
Well, our premiers, our mayors, you know, all the people who we look to for leadership.
Are you satisfied that they're adequately seized of this issue at the moment?
Well, they have many issues. I'm going to play the political game here and not respond to that question.
Okay, Barry, and then Stephen Buckley.
About bikes, the Chinese company Baidu is developing a fully autonomous, self-delivering bike. So in fact, if you want to bike somewhere, you use your smartphone, you call up a self-delivering bike, it comes to your front door, and you go to where you're going, and then it goes to other customers. No, this is real, though.
It's a real deal.
This is a real deal.
Huh. Stephen.
Yeah, and I'll close. My division's in charge of cycling within the city of Toronto, so I can answer this. We're in charge of road safety. First, I mean, the autonomous vehicle, I don't see that we're going to get huge capacity issues out of it, out of the gate. I think the biggest benefit we're going to see is safety. And over the past decade, we've had a massive shift. We're very good at keeping people in vehicles safe, and what has become sort of the fatalities and the serious injuries has migrated toward the vulnerable road users. So 85-90% of vehicular traffic fatalities are human error. So to the extent we can sort of take humans out of driving, positive. And also, it creates a better environment for cycling. People will feel safer. If we don't need the parking on the street, it will open up some additional space for bike lanes. We won't have this war on the whatever. Everyone will be able to sort of find their space in the city. So I think there's multiple benefits here. And I think that ultimately out of the gate, though, the biggest one is sort of the safety benefits.
Philippe.
Yeah, so about 40% of my time is actually working on cycle promotion with our member countries. And I have to say that this is the exact, that's the right point. That if you can make the city safer by infrastructure spend or by making the vehicles less frequently running into people and damaging them and killing them, then you're going to get the real benefit from cycling, which is not, frankly, helping those that are already riding get around better. And most of them are relatively young men. They will bicycle no matter what. It's getting the people that aren't cycling, that aren't walking out. And that means older people. That means people much younger than I. That means women. That means my grandmother. And once you get that population, when you get a demographic that cycling and walking that is the same demographic as in the city, then you've got a real city that is delivering on the benefits of active mobility.
Let's do Antonio, and then we'll give the minister the last word.
There's a fine point in what Stephen mentioned, which is, as new capacity gets generated on the roads, we quickly need to seize it up, not to accommodate more vehicles, but rather for the walking, for the cycling, bigger sidewalks, cycling paths, and do all those kinds of things. Because induced traffic, if we create the capacity, within a year we'll just be plugged up with vehicles all over again, and then it's harder to take that space back.
Stephen Del Duca, everything we heard tonight is all on your shoulders. So we'll give you the last word for that.
So on the cycling piece itself, you're probably aware that a couple of years ago, thanks to the leadership of my predecessor in this portfolio, Glenn Murray, the province did launch Cycle On, our first ever specific cycling strategy. With respect to the hopes and aspirations that you have kind of writ large here on this discussion, I would only ask that you stay tuned, because I expect that there'll be more information coming out on what additional phases of our cycling strategy will look like. So stay tuned. With respect to all of it being on my shoulders, Mr. Pakin, all I can say is I'm happy I have no hair left to pull out.
Good. Can I ask Cherise Berta to come back to center stage here and just wrap us up for the evening?
Great. Thank you so much. This was an incredible event. I learned a lot of things that I hadn't thought about. It's certainly going to help our work going forward. And hopefully everyone here learned new things and got a lot out of this event tonight. Just one thing, AV Meetup was the top trending issue tonight on Twitter. It's great to hear. And I think I mentioned at the beginning that we were live streaming with all these cameras around. And just so you know, the webcast will be available on our website for about 3 months. So if you're dying to see it again or catch that amazing quote from one of them or share it with friends, our website is Ryerson City Building Institute. So I just want to wrap up by thanking all of our unpanelists. And taking time out of your busy schedules and spending so much of this evening with us tonight. It was just such an incredible format. I thought I got a lot out of it. And in particular, Philippe, who came all the way from Paris or Nashville, we're not really sure. Julia and Barry, all the way from Ottawa. Minister Del Duca, all the way from Queen's Park. But you're a busy, busy person. Thank you to all of the panelists. You're fantastic. Please give them a hand. They were great. And thank you to our awesome moderator, Steve Pakin. Rumor has it there's an episode coming up on the agenda on this issue.
The rumor, your sources as always are fantastic. Yes, some of this group is going to come to TVO tomorrow. We're going to tape a discussion about some of what you've heard tonight. And if you haven't signed up for the Agenda Daily e-blast to let you know what's on, go to our website, tvo.org. You can do that, and then you'll know when this episode is going to air.
Great. And also, one more thing, if you did not find out about this event through our Ryerson mailing list, please get on our mailing list so you can find out about future events. Just simply sign up at the table where you signed in or drop off a business card, which is actually easier. And thank you again to all of you.
Can I do one more thing?
Yes.
One last thing. The guy 10 years ago who created the agenda with me, is the guy responsible for putting this whole, well, I shouldn't say putting the whole thing together tonight, but he produced this conference tonight with Cherise, and I just want him to get some recognition in front of this crowd. It's Dan Dunsky right over here. Dan. Okay, that's enough. That's enough. Dan left TVO not too long ago because he was sick of working with me, but I'm delighted that we're back in the saddle together tonight, Dun-Dun, so thanks a lot for everything you did to make tonight happen.
Great, so we have the whole TVO mafia tonight with us. Well, thanks everybody for being here tonight. I guess that's the end. Get home safely. Say a kind word to your Uber driver or your taxi driver or your streetcar driver before we become driverless. Have a great night.